sharing my screen. Yeah. So today's topic is Impala. Okay. So we'll discuss so few things about Impala, and let's see how to connect to it, and how is it similar to Hive, and if there are any differences that we need to consider. Let's focus on that. So by now, almost everyone got the birth history of Impala, I think. So in Hive or Pig, they both use MapReduce as the map processing engine in the backend, which is batch processing. Yeah. So since this is MapReduce batch processing, it used to take lots and lots of minutes, and it is still taking that much of time. Even if you do apply all those optimizations, your Hive is not suitable for real-time response. Real-time response in the sense, you can't expect your results to be within microseconds or seconds. Okay. So for that purpose, you should rely on some other system. If you have 1,000 million or just 1 million or even 10 million records, if you run a query, simple queries, even then it will take 1-2 minutes. So which is not bearable and will be eating up all the business users' time. Okay. Because of the slowness, so people wanted to switch, or they wanted to find out an alternative for this. And as I was already giving you this information, so being in as a commercial vendors, both Cloudera and Hortonworks, they started with their own innovations. And Cloudera came up with Impala, and Hortonworks came with Tej to overcome the slowness of your Hive. And this Tej engine is not separate tool within a Hive itself. Instead of MapReduce, we use Tej as a processing engine. Then you will get minimum 2 times speed is guaranteed, 2 times to 4 times you can see speed than MR. But here, this is written in like Java, and it also uses the same map tasks and reduce tasks concept, but it uses some optimized DAG, directed acyclic graph of maintaining these tasks to run there. But coming to Impala, it's completely a new architecture, whereas your Hive is like a client software, right? So you just need to have your Hive CLI on the edge node and Hive Metastore running on one machine. That's enough. So whenever you submit any queries, that query will be fired through your Hive shell, and that will be sent to your Hive driver on the same machine. That Hive driver will matches the metadata that is present in the Metastore and submits that query to the resource manager as a MapReduce job. Okay, so here components wise, we talked about, like, you don't need to have your Hive to be installed on each of your slave machines. Let's say if you have 20 node cluster. So architecture wise, it is sufficient to have just the Hive on edge node and Hive Metastore running CLI on edge node and Hive Metastore running on one of the 20 nodes. Okay, so these two are sufficient for us. Metastore is MySQL or Postgres running in any one of those machines is sufficient for us. It's not complete master slave architecture. It's just a on a client machine, you're converting your Hive queries into your MapReduce tasks, MapReduce jobs, and those jobs will be submitted to your resource manager. So Cloudera is Impala implementation thought out of the box. It didn't follow this approach. It completely took a different path of massive parallel processing, taking the massive parallel processing capacity, meaning you're able to submit parallel tasks to all your slave machines at a time. Massive parallel processing. So MPP, this is called as MPP technique and written in C++ language. And when you compare the performance at languages level, C++ languages will be C++ run faster than your Java. That is one reason why Impala was written in C++. And almost all any new implementations from Cloudera, they are being done in C++ only. Okay. But limiting our scope just to Impala. Here, massive parallel processing, and this is a master-slave architecture. Master-slave architecture, but not just the client-side software. You will have your separate services running on all the 20 nodes. Whereas in case of Hive architecture, you didn't have a service running for Hive in each of the 20 data nodes. It was just the YARN framework. Okay? YARN framework and MapReduce processing engine. But here in Impala, you will not have any interaction with your YARN resource manager at all. Even the resources that get allocated to your Impala, they are just out of your YARN resources. Architectural wise or the administration wise, if they want to merge with YARN resource manager, they can do that. But that degrades the performance of your Impala. So that one disadvantage. But if you don't merge it with YARN resource manager, the problem is resource pooling and maintaining of queues and some of the administration stuff becomes a limitation towards Impala. That's some of the issues that we are currently facing in our real time. Meaning, there won't be any resource utilization queues. Meaning, if you have 100 users, all 100 users requests will be submitted across that entire cluster. So ideally, the purpose of queues means 10 users for 10 users, they give for 10 different users, for similar kind of 10 users, they allocate one queue. And in that one queue, they might allocate 10% of the total resources, total processing resources. Okay, so this much of RAM memory, this much of CPU cores, this queue can use at max. So now anyone in this user group, or this any user that belongs to this queue or submits a job in towards this queue, it can't utilize more than 10% of the total resources, which is something like you are restricting your users to not use 100% of resources. Using this way, you are balancing the requests of all different types of users. In that case, at any time, if anyone from these 100 users submits a request, they will have some space to run their applications. If there are 10 teams working parallelly on your Impala cluster, and if one team itself is submitting very huge queries, and if that team itself is, if that user itself is getting all the resources, then you are not making justice to other 99 users. To avoid such scenarios, in any schedulers or in any resource management tools, it's not just in Yarn, even in the older schedulers and resource management tools, you will find the concept of this maintaining of these queues. And these queues are supported in Yarn, but not thoroughly in Impala. So if a user submits a one bad aggregation query, which eats up almost 90% of your cluster resources, then only 10% of the resources will be left out for all other users. Okay. So there are some implementations, or there are some improvements going on this area from Cloudera. So this limitation, I didn't find any other things that we can discuss. Like, or rest all are like it's positive things only. So you can't beat the performance of Impala with any other the existing tools except Spark. Okay, so now, so this is just the background overview about Impala. Let's now jump into the architecture. For Impala especially, I didn't have any fancy kind of slides prepared, so yeah, but it's not that much required also. It's more or less similar to this thing, high command wise. But let me share some links that can give you the basic documentation and the commands that you can refer to. Okay.
Siva, sorry, quickly. When you said 10 users, one person, that line, one queue, that 10% of total processing.
Do you have awareness on any scheduler where the jobs, how the jobs get scheduled and how the resources get allocated?
Like any kind of ETL tool, right, has a scheduler, right?
Okay. Then what is the purpose of maintaining the queues? No queues maintained there.
Queue meaning?
See, you have only one ticket counter and at a movie theater. If there is no queue at all, then it will become one big long queue. The seats are just 100 only. If you maintain one queue, and if that first guy itself buys all the 100 tickets, The rest, all 99, will be in waiting. If you divide that 100 tickets into 10 queues, and there are 10 counters, and people are waiting in those 10 lines.
But I can do also that using Hive. I can open multiple MR jobs, right?
Multiple MR jobs. By same single user, you ran two jobs. And those two jobs are eating up all the entire cluster resources.
Okay. But in this case, it won't.
In this case, see, in Hive, you can restrict that. Here, I'm just telling you, this is a limitation of your Impala. It's not the strength of Impala. That's
okay, I got it.
Hive, it's the strength of Hive.
I see. That's what got through me. Okay. Yes. It's a limitation. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So, coming to this Impala, let me explain you the architecture. And some of the query execution is fast when compared to the other tools which use MapReduce. Impala provides high performance and low latency SQL queries. So very high performance. So Impala integrates very well with Hive Metastore. So, and that's the way it maintains a single copy of your tables. You don't need to maintain multiple copies of your tables. Once you create a table in Hive, so that will be available both in Hive and as well as Impala. Because the underlying Hive Metastore is being used by your Impala. At the time of compilation, even in Impala, when you submit a query in from any of the Impala daemon, so that will be validated again as that Metastore, Hive Metastore. It runs, it uses that, so that's why it can able to access the Hive tables as well. Now, one point that you should keep in mind is that to run Impala, you have a dependency on Hive in the sense, especially the Hive Metastore component. You should have Hive already installed on your cluster. Hive Metastore running somewhere. Okay, so on top of Hive, along with Hive, so if it is Cloudera, so by default they will provide us this Impala. Okay. Now, it's coming to this architectural components in this. Compatible with Hive QL syntax, and Impala integrates well with Hbase database system, same as your Hive. So Hive also integrates with your Hbase. In the same way, even Impala recently started supporting the integration with Hbase. And Impala is interactive, but Hive is batch oriented, meaning it takes long time and it's very quick responsive. Okay, now coming to these architectures and daemons. So, in Impala, mainly three types of daemons will be there. And these are like Impala D, and state store D, and catalog D. Okay, so you might not be hearing these two catalog D or state store D, daemon names that frequently, but when you are working with Impala, you will almost you will observe everywhere hearing about this Impala daemon queue. And this is like your node manager being run on every slave node. So that way, Impala D is like a slave service which will be running one copy running on one node.
Sure.
Yes, Satish.
So when you use Impala, so do you need, do we need like Java?
Java? Your voice is breaking.
Java client.
Java client? Yes, you can write that.
Like for Hive, we use Java client, right? So same for Impala, do we need Java client?
Yep, yep. Anyway, let me explain these topics. I'm going to explain all those things, Satish. Okay, let's not directly jump there. So Impala D will be installed. This daemon will be started on every data node, and this is the one that actually performs your tasks. And this is the core of your Impala execution engine. And it uses the Hive meta store. Okay. And it can accept the queries from Impala shell, or even if you submit through the Hue browser from the web browser, the web GUI interface, or either you submit a JDBC or ODBC connections or this request, same like the way you have seen the Hive JDBC client. So you can write Impala JDBC client also. So through Java, you can fire your requests to your Impala. And whenever you make any connection request, so those connections will be sent to at least they should be sent to one of these Impala daemon services. And typically these services will be running on 21,000 port number. The way you have seen 10,000 port number for Hive Server 2 or Hive Server 1. Okay, here this 21,000 port number is for Impala daemons. Okay, and whatever the machine that Impala daemons are running, and those machines you can take and you can connect to any one of those Impala daemons on this 21,000 port number. Okay, and in general, in real-time scenarios, instead of allowing you to connect to any of these Impala daemons that are running in the background, what they will do is they will do a load, they will give you a load balanced URL, load balanced URL. The reason is if you suppose if I take only three machines, like so host one, so 21,000 port number, and host two, 21,000 port number, and host three, 21,000 port number. Now here, if as a end user, if we give you all the three host names and port numbers, and if everybody is connecting to host 1, 21,000, and it gets overburdened. So from this machine, you will get too many requests, and from there, the tasks will get distributed to other machines. And this JDBC, Impala has the limit on JDBC connections, maximum limit on JDBC connections. So each daemon based on the server capacity. So if it is having maybe 100 GB for each machine and some 10 cores or 20 cores, so based on the number of cores and the RAM that you allocate, so it might have some 50 connections or 100 connections. Okay, so 100 connections max. Then, so if you directly give this host name and port numbers to the end users, they might connect to any of these machines. And there is no one to balance the load on these three machines equally. That's why generally these administrators will give as the load balanced URL. So instead of giving you host name, they will give as Impala, something like Impala shell or Impala interface, Impala.interface. They gave the host name as Impala.interface. That's 21,000 port number. And whenever you submit a request to this URL, then what they will do is, based on the workload on the existing three machines, it will split the work into three machines. So it does that load balancing for us at runtime. Okay, so we don't need to worry about that. This is something that you will come across in real time. Okay, but for now, since in your quick start VMs, you will have only one machine that is running, and on that you will have only one Impala daemon running. So you won't be able to observe that load balanced URL there. But it's just nothing but one another host name, like similar to our host name. Okay. Now, this Impala daemon service, this will be running on each and every machine. And it parallelizes the queries and distributes work across the cluster and transmits intermediate query results back to the central coordinator node. Here, you are coming across this one more keyword, like central coordinator node. So in case if you have Impala daemon ID1, ID2, so ID3, all these are running. And as I was telling, Impala daemon will be running on all these three machines. And you can connect to any one of these machines. But you will be sending requests to only one of these machines in the beginning, right? You should interact with only one of these machines for the first time. So your request, when you submit your query, that will be sent to only one of these machines first, either ID1, Impala daemon 1, or Impala daemon 2, or Impala daemon 3. So assuming the query is submitted to Impala daemon 2, so now this acts like your coordinator node until the completion of your Impala query. This coordinates with two other Impala daemons, ID1 and ID3. And it distributes the task to ID1 and ID3. And once the ID1 is completed, ID1 sends the temporary results back to ID2, and ID3 sends the temporary results back to ID2, and this consolidates the results and displays the result values, or sends the result values back to the client. So the point here is that one among these Impala daemons acts as a coordinator node until the completion of your Impala query executions. So if you want to compare this with Yarn, so ID1s, ID1, ID2, ID3 all are like node managers, and whichever the node manager, I mean, whichever the Impala daemon that runs the, that acts like a coordinator node, so that one you can call as app master. So even the app master will run on one of the node managers in Yarn, right? And that will be active during only till the execution of your MapReduce job. And this is responsible for distributing the work to all other node managers. The same way, your coordinator node is responsible for distributing the work to other Impala daemons and collecting the results from there and gathering the progress statistics as well. Okay. So that's a bit about this thing. Impala D running on a data node which is user submitted query will act as a coordinator for that query. And coming to the next two other types of daemons, the state store D, the state stored daemon, which runs in the background the Impala state store service. It is just to monitor the availability of all Impala services across the cluster. Meaning, whichever machines are providing these Impala services and which are not available now. It handles the situation such as nodes becoming unavailable. All of a sudden, if one node goes down, the state store will keep monitoring the availability of all these machines. Okay, so by looking at your, whenever the end user submits a query to any Impala daemon, that acts as coordinator node. But now, coordinator node should know to which all other Impala daemons it should send his tasks. Correct? So that information, so who are all active and who can take the tasks? So that information will be available in the state store daemon. So this coordinator node sends a request to state store D to get the active Impala daemon nodes and inactive Impala daemon nodes. And this is something like your resource manager. Resource manager, but not completely identical to that, because in resource manager, any request from the external client that flows through resource manager to node application master and application master to node managers. But here, directly, the connection will directly happen to this node manager, the Impala daemon, and that acts as a coordinator node. And coordinator node fetches information from state store D. Tell me what are all the active nodes on which I can run. And state store daemon installed on one instance of N node cluster, only one machine will be running this. And state store daemon is a name service, meaning it just keeps the names of all the Impala Ds. It keeps track of which Impala Ds are up and running and relays this information to all the Impala Ds in the cluster. So they all will be aware of this information when distributing tasks to other Impala Ds. And so unlike your resource manager being a single point of failure in Yarn, here, this is not a single point of failure. Since Impala daemons still continue to function even when state store daemon dies, because they already might have got the latest snapshot of information. What are all the active daemons and what are all not active? With that information being in hand, they can still continue the execution. They don't, because you are not sending your requests through state store D to Impala daemons. You are directly sending your requests to Impala daemons, and Impala daemons rely on your state store D only for the first time to get the, all the active Impala daemons. And at regular time intervals, your state store D keeps sending the active list of Impala daemons and inactive list of Impala daemons. Unless until there is that much frequent note downs, there won't be much change, even for 2 days, 3 days. Okay. Your slave missions don't go down that frequently, right? Not like every 1 hour or 2 hours or 3 hours. Maybe going once in a week or once in a month, that might be the frequency. So in that case, if state store D has gone down, this service has gone down, then even then you can still keep submitting your request to your Impala daemons, and they know the status, whatever the status they have in hand. With that, they will distribute their task to other Impala Ds, and they keep collecting the information. And meanwhile, you can bring your state store D back to normal status, and then again it starts monitoring the active services and inactive services. Okay. Then, so one another service that will be running on your Impala clusters is this catalog D. And it is the responsible for interacting with your Hive metastore and fetching the metadata from Hive metastore. And it distributes the metadata from Hive metastore to all the Impala daemons. So it distributes metadata, meaning table names, column names, and their data types, to Impala daemons via the state store D, which acts as a publish and subscribe mechanism. So all your Impala daemons subscribe to state store D machine, and that state store D machine, whatever it publishes, that message will be received to all the Impala daemons, and along with who are all active and who are all not active, the state store D also sends the metadata snapshot that is received from catalog D daemon. And this is also not a single point of failure, since Impala daemons still continue to function. The user has to manually run a command to invalidate metadata if there is an update to it. If all of a sudden this catalog D daemon has gone down, if you run this command, invalidate metadata or refresh, catalog D service, if you run the refresh command or invalidate metadata command from your Impala shell, that fetches the latest snapshot of the metadata from your Hive metastore directly. Okay, in case if you're catalog D daemon is down. Otherwise, if this service is up and running, it will do that job for us at regular intervals of time. So it will be fetching the latest snapshot of the metadata at regular intervals of time, like maybe every 1 hour or so. Okay, this catalog D service avoids the need for refresh and invalidate metadata statements when the metadata changes are performed by the statement issued through Impala. So whenever you create a new table or you alter a table to add a column or or change the data type, then that metadata change, to get that change in the metadata, you don't need to run these two commands. If you have this catalog D daemon service type. But if you create any table through your Hive shell, then if that table to be available in Impala daemon immediately, so at regular intervals of time, your catalog D will fetch that information also. But as and when you create the table in Hive and you want that table to be available in Impala as well, then you should run this refresh command or invalidate metadata command from the Impala shell. Okay. And if we keep these two daemons aside, and these can be run on any one of the machines of your cluster, but on every data node, you will have your Impala daemon also running. And see, if you observe here, this is one data node, and this is another data node, and this is another data node. So here, HDFS data node daemon is running, HBase slave service is also running. And similarly, you can assume your Yarn's node manager is also running. And along with those all other slave services, you also have your Impala daemon. And inside this Impala daemon, same like your Hive driver components, the compiler, the optimizer, planner, and executor. That way, here you have the query planner and query coordinator and query execution engine. So query planner is the one which decides how many tasks it should trigger or it should initiate. So that plans how many tasks to be submitted. And coordinator is the one which submits your tasks to all other Impala daemons and coordinates with other machines to collect the temporary results. It just takes care of handshaking between all other things, and this is the one. Query exec engine is the one actually runs the tasks in each of these Impala daemons. So this is responsible for coordinating with this query coordinator is responsible for getting the results from other machines, and inside this machine, this query exec engine is the one that executes your query. Okay. And if you just want to know the steps that involves here, then client sends a request to Impala D, and Impala D will accept that request. And now Impala D will fetches the metadata from Hive Metastore and HDFS NN. So if it is already available in catalog D, and that sends through these state store D daemon, and that will be available with Impala daemon. But in case, if you don't have the metadata of the newly created tables from Hive, then you will run this refresh or invalidate metadata. In that case, it will directly fetches metadata from Hive Metastore. Now, Impala D will fetches the state of other Impala daemons. Okay, so which is received from state store D daemon. Now, this Impala D knows what are all the slave machines that I can use. Thus, all the Impala D and to those slave machines, it sends the tasks. And thus, all the Impala Ds will start execution of query, which is received from client. And the partial results will be combined at coordinator machine and sent back to your client. And Impala D catches this metadata for fast access. So this is what I was talking about. Right? The catalog D fetches the metadata and sends that to every Impala daemon through the state store D. Okay, and they catches the metadata for fast access. And Impala will be best fit for Parquet file format, or Parquet file format is the best fit for, I mean, best combination to use with Impala. And one of the limitations, another limitation that should highlight is, so coming to the Impala limitations, resource pooling, this is high level, not related to developers. You don't need to worry about, at least from your end. So it's not your task. Okay. So coming to other limitations, your ORC file formats are not supported in Impala. ORC file formats are not supported in Impala. So that's why if you are using in any Cloudera distribution, if you are working in Cloudera distribution, even in Hive, it is not recommended to use, it is not recommended to create tables with ORC file formats. Because if you create a table with just the ORC file format, then that is useless in Impala. You can't use the same table in Impala, so which is again is the, so one global copy of your data. Otherwise you need to maintain two copies, one with ORC file format and the other with the whatever the file format that Impala supports. So currently Impala supports like text files and sequence files and RC files and Parquet. But RC and sequence files, Cloudera has stopped their enterprise support on these file formats, considering or marking these as deprecated file formats, and they are no longer, they will no longer be supporting these formats. So you will get only the enterprise support for the text files and the Parquet files. These are older file formats. You don't need to. You will not find any strong reasons to use these two file formats. Okay, because your Parquet is compresses your data so much better than these two other files, and it runs much faster than those two other file formats. And obviously you need the text file format because to copy your temporary data, and the same way you have seen in dynamic partitioning, and if you have your data loaded in text format or text files in somewhere, and if you want to convert that into Parquet, so you should have, we saw that we were using the text file formatted tables as temporary. Okay. So that is one limitation, and the one I was. So the best combination that you should always prefer with Impala is Parquet. Create a table Parquet with file format Parquet and run it in Impala. And if you want to apply the compression technique, you can set the property same as in your Hive. Set Parquet compression type underscore compression type equal to snap. So this property if you can set, so when you are writing data into your Parquet files, automatically those Parquet files will get compressed to Snappy. And this is the recommended combination with your Impala. Impala with Parquet with Snappy compression technique. And especially with Impala, and for Parquet files, we need to maintain higher block sizes, not like your typical HDFS files. So typical HDFS files will have 128 MB block sizes. But for Parquet files, Parquet files perform better if you can have at least 1 GB block size. Okay, so meaning, I mean, here also, it also expects like your files should not be too less or too small. Okay, your packet file sizes expect, I should not say as expect, they perform better if you have a block size of 1 GB for your packet files. You can set that for block size at the time of creation of your packet files using some of these properties in block size. Compression codec as Snappy, and you can specify somewhere there is a property that you can specify the block size. What is it, Satish?
When you mention this one,
your voice is breaking, Satish.
When you mention like 1 GB block size, so this is for HDFS block size, right?
Yes, for those files.
Siva?
Yes, Anu.
Siva, what do you, what does Impala, those daemons use, do by getting the metadata? Why do they need to get to the metadata frequently?
For fast retrieval?
No, that's understandable. Mm-hmm. But that metadata is more maintained by Hive, right? So,
yep.
Impala will get the metadata and do what? For the querying purpose?
Of course. What is the need for metadata?
Because table definitions, right? The table definitions.
So why do we need table definitions at the time of querying? To validate whether the user given columns are valid or not, it has to check against the metadata, right? You have four columns in a table and the user is trying to access, he's requesting you 8 columns. Then you should tell the user that these four columns are not there in this table.
But that will be taken care of by Hive, right? If a user is sending a query, mm-hmm. Hive will access metadata. Remember that whole thing you showed about Hive?
Yeah.
Right, that will be taken care of by the Hive engine itself, right?
If you submit it into Hive engine, Hive will take care. If you submit it to Impala, who needs to take care?
So the Impala will just read the Hive metadata. Mm-hmm. The underlying HDFS queries will be sent by Hive only, right?
Underlying HDFS queries will be run against Hive?
Uh-huh.
If that is the case, then how does it improve the performance? It will not run this queries against Hive. That's what I'm trying to say here. So it executes. So that's why you don't have Hive services running at all on the slave machines.
Mm-hmm.
Your Impala daemons will have the services running on every data node, and they will have a dedicated amount of resources, like 100 GB allocated from each machine out of 256 GB, and 10 cores available for your Impala daemons out of 48 or 40 cores. That way, your Impala daemons will have a set of resources allocated from each of these slave machines, and this will be running. And inside these Impala daemons, all your query executions will happen. This query execution engine is present inside the Impala daemons itself.
Okay.
You just rely on Hive Metastore just to get the metadata.
Got it. It's just like a table. It's a file.
Yeah.
It's a file. Okay. Essentially, no, nothing for Hive is being used. Okay.
It's basically all MySQL, right?
On MR jobs, if the file is large. File is large. Which file? Which file are we talking about? Oh, okay. This okay. This Parquet file sizes. Parquet files. When you use these Parquet files in MapReduce framework, the same Parquet files. Is that your question, Narendra? Okay. Yeah. Obviously, that for 1 GB block, only one map task will be submitted. It slows down your performance bit with respect to MapReduce. So generally, this is a best combination for Impala, but not for other tools like. Okay, so Impala with Parquet file format and with Snappy compression codec and with 1 GB block size there. Okay.
I have one question, Neetu here. When we are saving a file in a Snappy compression format on the HDFS and while dividing it into the blocks, will that be divided into the compressed format only? This 1 GB will be a compressed size or a flat size?
Compressed files, if you don't specify the compression technique, is that your question?
Yes.
If you don't specify the compression technique, and even at the cluster level, if there is no default configuration, obviously it will not get compressed.
How do we deal with the compressed files in HDFS?
You don't need to explicitly deal separately with the compressed files. Your HDFS framework is I can say wise enough to read your files. That's it. You can just specify. You don't even, while reading your files anywhere in MapReduce or anywhere in Hive or something, even if it's compressed, you don't need to specify the compression technique. This is using this compression technique, read this with. It identifies the compression technique while reading. It can process that. You can try with creation of one ORC file format or RC file in Hive itself and enable the compression technique on that. And then you can read that file back in another Hive table, just pointing to that location. Your frameworks will take care of reading that compression techniques. You don't need to explicitly set up anything for that.
Okay, one thing. When we are specifying that one block size is 128 MB, if the file, this 128 MB is a compressed size or a not compressed size?
Compressed. Yeah, if you specify the compression technique, so after compression, it will break this thing into 128 MB.
So actual file size would be larger, right?
Yep, actual file size would be larger.
And block will be able to accommodate that?
Block?
Yeah, block size limit is 128 MB. So will it be able to accommodate the uncompressed large file size, which will be more than 128 MB because...
Into this blocks?
Yeah, blocks.
Yes, it can split. It can do that. Whether it could be it's compressed or uncompressed, it will be able to split them into blocks. Same HDFS concept, like if you upload any file, whether it's a compression applied or not applied. Oh, okay. I'm getting your question. What if the compression technique is not Snappy? Is that your question? Snappy compression.
Maybe I'm not getting the basic, but for me, compression means zipping the files, right?
Zipping. See, Z-zip compression technique will not allow the file to be split into blocks. That's not splittable.
Yeah, Snappy is not splittable.
Snappy is splittable.
Snappy is splittable. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Okay.
Yes, Anand.
So far, what we have learned so far from, so only pig is kind of optional, but we need HDFS, MapReduce,
yep.
Hive.
You need HDFS and MapReduce a bit. And that, I mean, why are you taking it as mandatory where you would need some for loops and kind of stuff? Okay. Yeah, I got your point. And so in my opinion, MapReduce is also almost optional. Almost. Okay.
No, but
if you are a very good SQL programmer, so I have seen some experts, like they, any use case, they will be able to write some kind of queries and they get.
Right. But the reason I'm saying MapReduce is always used, right? I will submit MapReduce queries.
Okay. Maybe you are seeing it as like architecture point of.
Correct.
I'm telling in the developer's perspective, MapReduce may become completely optional. Okay. So yeah, HDFS is mandatory, Hive is mandatory, and Impala is mandatory. Okay. Yeah, so this combination I wanted you to ingest into your minds, like Impala, RK, Snappy Compression Codec, 1GB block size. Okay, take this just one statement. I mean, this, whatever the statement that I'm giving you, these all come out of some POCs that we perform. Okay, so not just the sake of statements. We do backend all, so once few statements that we make, which one runs faster? Like I was giving you trade-off between all these file formats with respect to performance, right? So text files, sequence files, RC files, ORC, Parquet. So these things, I just gave you the details of these things in 10-15 minutes. But to finalize or to prove them, we almost took like 1.5 month or 2 months of time over a period of, I mean, on a data of at least 20 TB data, we performed all these queries. So stored in different formats and applied all the compression techniques, all varieties of compression techniques, and played with all different types of block sizes. So much stuff. And finally, we concluded the best combinations. Okay, so that's why I want people to follow the best standards. Like instead of you starting from the beginning and finding out so which one runs faster and which one will be better. Yeah.
Yes, you have a very basic question.
Mm-hmm.
Where do we mention our about the 1GB block size? Is it while transferring the file?
While moving your data into your table load, you can set dfs.block size, right?
Nice.
Your property, dfs.size.
So while loading the file, is it?
Yeah, I mean, while loading data into the table.
Right, okay, got it. Yeah.
See, you will create a table with stored as parquet.
Correct, right? Yeah.
And you will have data somewhere in the text file or something.
Right, got it. Okay, so while loading, I can
do this. You will be loading, and before loading that, if you set this these two properties, since it is creating parquet files, it applies this codec as API and the block size as 1GB. And once you come out of, once after completion of this query, even if you come out of the shell, that doesn't matter to you. This property is no longer need. At the time of creation of this file, these two properties were active and those were got applied on this parquet file.
Okay, thanks. Yeah.
See one thing quickly. So while querying, we'll be using daemons, but while writing the tables, it will write to the metastore, Hive metastore, right?
Metadata will be written into Hive metastore. The data will be written into HDFS. Your Impala table is again nothing but same as your Hive. It's nothing but
data in HDFS and RDBMS metadata. HDFS data and RDBMS metadata. So it does both. So it sends the metadata to the store and data to HDFS.
So essentially, we may not require Hive to have to create the tables. We can just create tables directly from Impala.
I see. Of course. Yes, okay, you can create tables directly from Impala.
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
So you don't have dependency on your Hive shell at all. We don't have dependency on Hive shell at all.
Okay. So then essentially Hive is
on only on Hive Metastore.
Got it.
Shiva?
Yes, Katila.
In a Hive, like we have a Hive RC file where we declare all the configuration, right? In Impala.
Dot Hive RC file. Yeah, that will be placed in conf directories. So any initialization properties that you can, so the way this set property, you can specify in that dot Hive RC whenever you open your Hive shell. So those properties will get applied before it opens up that Hive shell for you.
Okay, one more question. Like in case of Pig and Hive, when we submit a query or when it get executed, it will run MR jobs, right? Will it be the same case with Impala?
No, it will not use that MapReduce technique at all. It doesn't use,
then,
if it is using the MapReduce, even it would be around the same performance.
Yeah, if it is not using MR, how is it coordinating with all the?
Okay, again coming back to the original architecture. See, it uses its own technique, that massive parallel processing. Whenever you get any request, it could be from your Impala shell or the JDBC or ODBC, you will be connecting to one of the Impala daemons and you will have the daemons running on each machine and they will be responsible for running your queries. You are not relying on your node manager or MapReduce task. In case if it is MapReduce, so you are sending tasks to node manager on this machine and node manager on this machine and node manager on this machine.
Okay, now, in case of Impala, there is nothing related to YARN.
Nothing related to YARN.
Okay.
So you will have a separate services dedicated to your Impala. They run much faster. And how they got that much speed is something.
Their own algorithm. Might be their own algorithm.
Not even the algorithm. Let me explain you here. So if you use MR, you will have mainly like reading your input. In any typical MapReduce job, you need to read your input and it produces intermediate output. And finally, final output, right? Okay. So in MapReduce, this input will be read from disk, meaning the HDFS. Input will be read from HDFS. And intermediate output will be written into your map or output will be written into local file system, meaning the same disk. And final output.
The disk in case of HDFS is
different. Let me finish all these things. This final output will be written into your disk. Okay. Now coming to Impala. It reads in chunks of data, larger blocks into RAM. So meaning the purpose of maintaining 1 GB block size is that entire 1 GB block at a time into RAM memory. Okay. So one larger block into RAM memory. And your intermediate results also stored into RAM, and they will be read from RAM. And final output, obviously, if you want to write or save somewhere, it will be disk. This is out of scope. Okay, so this will not impact the performance, because anyway, if you are intended to store your output, you need to write into a file, no matter which technology you are using. Coming to Spark, it loads everything, entire file into, not just one block, entire file into RAM, and your intermediate data is also into RAM. Now, the meaning of disk is something that it reads from the HDFS directly, the line by line or record by record here. And if you write your intermediate output to your local file system, again, which is nothing but your hard disk only, right? Not the RAM memory. And from there, it has to read that intermediate output. So anytime reading from your RAM is much, much faster than reading from your disk, storage disk. And that too, if that is present in LFS, that will be a bit faster. But if that is present in HDFS, that is even more slower.
So in case of Impala and Spark, we are not using HDFS at all.
Of course. You are not directly reading it from line by line. Okay. You are loading block. See, reading from HDFS is different, loading from HDFS is different.
Okay, got it.
Load means take one block at a time and put it in RAM. From there, read it.
Okay. In case of Impala also, do we have parallel processing? How will it happen?
Same. If you receive anything, the query,
okay,
any query that you submit, this query planner is the decision maker, how many tasks it should submit, and based on the plug, how many tasks, this coordinator will request, will send a task to those many Impala daemons.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Here the query planner will, do you mean that here the query planner will fetch the data from all?
From all?
From all the daemons? From all the nodes?
No. See, query planner is something based on the query that you submitted.
Mm-hmm.
So it identifies how much complexity this is, query is, how many phases the logical plan it prepares. You have seen how many stages this will be there, right? So if you apply select and some aggregate functions, a where class and group by, order by, and again inner query, this thing. It will prepare a logical plan for that, right? So which needs to be run first, and which needs to be run next, and which needs to be run next, and like that. And it will identify how many tasks it should run. Same, I mean, if you are from Oracle background or somewhere, you will find all these components in your Oracle also. Maybe Anand can answer this. Right in the back end of your Oracle server, don't you
have
kind of planners, optimizers, and executors?
Absolutely.
In any query running tools or these things, servers, you will find these three tools present everywhere. The same three tools are present in, but not the coordinator, but the planner, optimizer, and executors are present in your Impala, in your Hive also.
and they are present in your pig driver also.
Okay.
And I didn't highlight much on the compiler part here. Of course, even that will be part on client side itself, client Impala shell itself.
Okay.
So what's the, I mean, I'm still not getting the confidence from you. You're still in dilemma or confusion.
Yeah, a little bit confusion. Let me figure it out like
okay.
After the session.
So what is that making you not able to digest it? It's the same sequence of steps in any server, in any typical database servers.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, Shiva.
Yeah. So those are few points that I wanted to bring to your notice. Then, so some of the recommendations are like 128 GB RAM on each data node. The Cloudera are recommended this thing on each machine. So meaning almost half of the resources you are allocating to Impala. The reason is it needs a lot of RAM memory because it loads everything, the blocks into RAM and also the intermediate output into RAM. That's why. And also if you are using Spark, even for Spark, because the advantage with Spark is it runs on YARN, and specifying huge amount of resources for YARN is will balance all the other tools also. Okay.
Shiva, I'm sorry, Shiva. Can you go back quickly?
Yes.
So can you just quickly revise that last table? You're saying that MapReduce has this HDFS, LF, and Impala has one larger block into RAM. What is the comparison you're trying to make here? I'm sorry, I lost a little bit here.
The comparison is your MapReduce directly reads record by record from HDFS. So it will be slower, but Impala, it will not read record by record from the HDFS file. It loads one block at a time into RAM, and from that, from RAM, it reads the record. So that's why it will be faster.
And in Spark, it loads the file itself into the RAM.
Yes, entire file itself. So that's why even it is much more faster.
Got it. So Spark
and the trade-off here is that you can run your MapReduce even with less RAM memory available on your cluster. And but your Impala needs at least 100 GB. The recommended RAM memory itself is 100 or 128 GB from Cloudera. And Spark is again like, so you should have at least 256 GB RAM dedicated for YARN itself. This expects even more larger RAM sizes.
And okay, perfect. And the intermediate disk output will be to the RAM, and then it will be finally to the disk.
Correct.
So you have a commit kind of something like that, right?
Yep.
Okay. So what's the difference between HCatalog and DCatalog?
HCatalog and?
DCatalog.
DCatalog.
Sorry, catalog D, something you said like.
Oh, okay. Catalog, the catalog daemon. Catalog daemon is something that fetches the data from your Hive metastore.
Okay. Then,
HCatalog, which I didn't include in our scope, but even that also maintains, or that also is a catalog of your metadata. Even that relies on Hive metastore only. But here, catalog D is available only for Impala. But HCatalog, if you use, that will be useful for, in case via pig, if you are in pig shell and if you want to access your Hive table, If you want to load Hive table as it is, you don't want to load the underlying file separately and by specifying the schema separately. If you want to load the table, Hive table directly into your Pig shell, you can use that Hcat loader or Hcat storer. That makes a connection to your Hive via that Hcat log. And similarly, if you want to create a Hive table through from Pig shell, you use Hcat loader and storer.
Okay.
And the same way, your MapReduce, from MapReduce, if you want to directly create a Hive Hive table, you can use that Hcat record writer or a Hcat record writer. But to be frank, that's not widely popular, or you don't have to mandatorily use that. The reason is, you can create a HDFS file from your MapReduce and create a table definition in Hive.
Yeah.
And same way in Pig, if you are accessing the file from your Hive, just directly access the file. If you know the table, you also know the path. Load the file and get the schema. Use that schema here.
Yeah, that's true. I was thinking
there
like
lots of limitations of your Hcat log with the data types conversions. Especially, I don't recommend to use Hcat log because it's still in incubating. It's not a mature top level project to start using that, and it has a lot of data type conversion issues. Whatever the data types that Hive supports, those all, you don't have corresponding data types that are supported in Pig to directly create Hive tables.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It's clear now, because like after hearing about catalog D, I was thinking even H catalog will be the same. So that's the reason why I was.
Yeah, it's kind of similar. Yep. But the scope of your H catalog is for your Pig and your MapReduce. Sometimes your HBase can also, but these days you can say Hcatalog is getting vanished or getting deprecated. No one is using, and there is no strong reason to use that.
Okay, like as you said, in case of Hive and Pig, if we know the path, we can directly access those files and load them. Yeah. So, won't it be the same case with Impala? If we know the Metastore path, can we load them directly?
If we know the file, yes, we can.
Okay, then there's no, then why catalog?
The problem with your Hcatalog, you have a different syntaxes and you have to use them load Hcat loader or Hcat storer. And you have to explicitly tell to access via that Hcat log, to access the metadata. Here, without your intervention, if you write a select query, automatically it does that in the backend.
Okay.
You don't need to worry about starting catalog daemon or making any request to catalog daemon.
Okay. Got it, Shiva. Thank you.
Okay. It's by default integrated.
Okay. Between Hive and Impala is integrated, whereas in other tools, it's not integrated.
It's not default integrated.
We need to run the daemon, right?
For Hcatalog?
Yeah.
Hcatalog, we don't need a daemon also. Okay. It's just a configuration through that Hcatalog store.
Okay, but there are so many...
Hive Metastore daemon will be running.
Okay, got it.
Okay, yeah, maybe for others, whoever is hearing this Hcatalog keyword for the first time, don't worry about that importance. You'll not be using much that. You'll not be using that in real time, like the reasons that I was explaining to her.
Shiva, I have one question now.
Yes, sir.
So how is Impala currently used in the real time world? Is it developers use that for SQL, or business users also who know SQL use the product?
It's both. See, business users, not much, but only if they know the SQL, they can use it. But the developers use it a lot.
But so, purely for SQL purpose, on the command line.
For SQL purpose.
Right, okay, makes sense.
Purely for SQL purpose. And one another reason is performance.
Yeah, of course.
Obviously. That's the major part of it. Performance. Right. SQL is anyway you're getting from Hive also, but that's the major thing.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, Impala commands, let me explain you for a few minutes. They are pretty same. Okay. Don't need to worry. So creation of database. There is no database specific properties to configure. There is no. A few highlights that I mentioned here in this article, it's good to go through them. Okay. So you can create database using the create database and database name statements, but you don't have alter database statement in Impala. So once the database is created, it's created. And same like in your Hive, if you create a database, a directory will get created, right? Same. Each database is physically represented by a directory in HDFS. Same way, same fashion. And same as in Hive. In Hive, the default database is default, right? Even in Impala, the default database is default.
Sorry to interrupt you, Shiva, here. There's no alternate database. That means, do we do from the Hive side then?
We can do that from Hive side. Yes.
Right, okay.
Even in Hive side, if you closely observe, what can you change for your alter with the alter database? You can add just some key value fields.
Yeah, I don't think you will never ever change the database once it's created.
Yeah, author is Lakshman.
Yes, yes, I know. Not even in Oracle. Nowhere you change that actually. Yeah. You may extend that. Maybe the size of the file or something, but that's
So that's the reason they didn't even give that feature.
Shiva, what will we use then for ETL?
What will be?
Be useful to load the data then. If Impala is only for querying and
querying, you see. Let me complete. Once you go through all these commands, you'll get. See, it's not just for running your select queries. You can create tables. You can load data. Yeah. Same whatever things that you did in Hive.
Okay. Perfect.
I'm coming there. So you can create databases in Impala. So the first step. Okay. So inside that database, you can create the tables with the same syntax that whatever you used in Hive. Okay. And here also in Impala, you have two types of tables, managed table or internal table, and the external tables. The same concept holds good in Impala. Managed tables are owned by Impala, and external tables are not owned by Impala, meaning the data will not get removed in case of external table drop, but in case of managed table drop, even the data also gets deleted along with the metadata. Your create table statement is pretty same as your Hive table creation. Let's see some table creations. Okay, we'll see in shell. And it also supports the views also, same as in your Hive. You can create views in Hive. And some table statements, create database, show databases, use database to switch into that. And this is the create table name, EMP, ID, int, name, string, age, float, salary, double, row format, delimited, fields terminated by comma. So all the primitive types of your Hive are also supported in Impala. So int, string, float, double, all these are present in Hive also, right? So those data types. And even the row format, delimited, fields terminated by comma, collections terminated by so and so. So all those are available here.
Shiva, can we access? We can't access. We cannot use those complex data types in.
Coming there.
Right. because I was having hell of issues with those issues.
I have listed those limitations somewhere in here. So we don't have the complex data types in Hive. So I was about to list down. So like complex data types as in the sense, this unions, maps, and even the structs, these are not there in Impala. So far we didn't see ORC files are not there in Impala. So complex data types are not there in Impala. Also, the bucketing feature is not there in Impala. Bucketing feature is not supported in Impala. So if you create any table in Hive with bucketing feature, you can't use that table in Impala.
Mm-hmm. Okay, because
so what are supported from Hive, if you consider, so all primitive data types, and the database creations, DDL statements, I can write in, it could be databases, tables, you can create tables, you can load data, you can query tables, and you have managed and external tables, and you have partitioning, the same partitioning mechanism, same, everything same, like dynamic partitioning, static partitioning, and subdirectories creation. Okay, partitioning is everything same, and support for views and support for nested queries, all these things.
Because when I was creating Hive table using those complex data types, I was feeling so much of issues. Like it was
okay. Yeah, complex data types are not supported in Impala. Okay. Here we saw a statement for creation of a database and show the database. Typical operations I have already listed down here. Create a database and show database and switch to that database and create a table. And you can specify fields terminated by comma or this thing. And if it is an external table, create external table if not exists. And if it is already, this is one important scenario that is, this is explicit scenario that is syntax that is available only in Impala, but which is useful. If you already have a parquet file created, and you want to load that as a table, you want to view that someone created a parquet file for you, some other team created a parquet file for you, and they gave that path of that parquet file. But you don't know how many columns and what are their data types in that. And they wanted you to view the data. You can simply create the table. Create table, table name, like, and give that parquet name, parquet path. So mostly your parquet files will have the metadata also present in this, that file. Meaning what are the columns and their data types along with the data. This advantage is there only with parquet files. Having the column names and data types also along with the data, but not with your sequence, not with your RC, not with your ORC, not with your text. Okay. And you can use your create table as select statement as it is, same as the way you use in MySQL or you use in Hive. And you can create partition tables by using partition by syntax. And you can use different file formats the way we have seen in Hive. Create table, table name. And if it is like, if it is a parquet, you can specify the parquet file. Or if it is like another table, you can specify
another table there, or if you don't want to use like at all, if you specify the table definition, the column names and the data types, and finally stored as Parquet file or stored as RC file or stored as sequence file or stored as text file, this is up to you, but not stored as ORC. And once you create table, the immediate next request from you might be just to show the tables, to view the list of all the tables. Yes, that is available. And if you want to load data, you have load data in path, and you can give the directory of your HDFS into table, table name. Here, one difference you have to keep in mind is that load data local in path is not supported in Impala, meaning you can't directly load your data from your local file system into your Impala table. You can use only the load data in path, but not load data local in path. I hope you still remember those syntaxes and don't get surprised now. Okay.
So the file has to be an HDFS, is it?
Yes, the input file has to be an HDFS.
Yeah.
It can read, your Impala can read. Impala load data in path command can only read from your HDFS, not from your LFS.
Interesting.
You don't have that load data local in path syntax.
Yeah. Okay.
So these are minor differences that I go through this thing. Okay. And inside your Impala HDFS cell, you are able to access your even HDFS command, but inside your Impala shell, you can't run your Hadoop FS commands. But that's not a big drawback at all. You can anyway run it from the terminal. And if you want to copy from one table to another copy, the same insert into table statement that was available in Hive, yes, it's available in Impala also. And your select queries are pretty normal as in Hive. Select star and select with where classes and select with some conditions, some functions, all your string functions are.
Sorry, I think you missed
it. And operators. Yep.
How do you go to the Impala shell or the prompt?
Coming.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
I thought I will show you all these commands, then I will show at least a couple of queries executed there. Okay. I will show you. And all comparison operators, arithmetic operators. So exists and not exist, and in and not in, and in. Strings comparisons are like similar to like. You can also use are like and regexp, but these two are strongly not recommended. They eat up lots and lots of performance. It's not just an Impala. It could be the Postgres or your MySQL or even Oracle.
Oracle,
performance.
Yeah.
They eat almost 3-4 times the speed of your like. If you could have specified the same in with multiple like statements also, they run much faster than your regular regexp or regular expression like R like. Okay. And if you want to drop a table, drop table table name. And if you want to drop a database, drop database database name. Okay. And this refresh and invalidate metadata, these two commands, you will run only from Impala shell. To get the latest snapshot of metadata or to access the latest table that you created in Hive in Impala as well. Okay. And some of the Impala performance tuning techniques we'll discuss. So before that, let me show you how to connect to your Impala shell and let's run few queries there. And your Impala JDBC client, same as in your Hive, instead of 10,000 port number, because Hive server 2 runs on 10,000 port number, but your Impala JDBC connections run on. So 21050, you can tell this
port number, and you can play with that. It points to JDBC, Hive 2 only, but the Impala drivers will run in this. Because it points to the underlying metastore, Hive metastore, this qualifier will remain as it is. And it the port number will change. The JDBC server running port number, 21210 50, but in your Impala shell, you'll connect it to. This was our B-line shell yesterday. So to connect to your Impala shell, Impala-shell minus I, the host name where your Impala JDBC server is running, in my case, quickstart.cloudera, on which port number? It usually runs on 21,000 port number. Okay, starting Impala shell without Kerberos, that is something security mechanism. Let's not worry. So this is the connection string that happened to this, the JDBC server that is running on this machine. Now here, it's pretty same like show databases. You can see all the databases from your Hive, your default and test underscore DB. These were the databases that you have in a Hive. And if you want to switch into test DB, can see the same ABCDEF and partition user, all these tables were there in Hive, if you remember still. And inside the default show tables, describe, formatted, all those commands, same. Describe, formatted customers. What happened? And it gives you more indented results than your Hive shell. Okay. So if you start using your Impala shell, you will like Impala shell more than your Hive shell. Okay. So this is text input format, some customers data. And so this is managed table, the same kind of information. And if you run select star from, whereas if you show the tables, see here it's just a plain list, but here you can see in them as a tabular format. See all the results also in tabular format. Okay, my terminal limit is just 500. So if we run here, there are total 12,870 rows are there. How many columns are there? Limit, let me see. You can see customer email, customer password, customer name, customer state. Okay. So let me write one query. Select count of star, count of star, count of, count of one, comma, customer state from customers, okay, group by customer state. So for each state, how many, for each state, how many customers are there? So from memory, I have 114. And if I want this to be sorted by, let's see, order by, I think this aliases are there, but within same. You can't use this alias in the same SQL, even in SQL. Okay. Yes, here it's okay. And descending and limit 10. I want to get the top 10 states with their counts. If this is my query, how many seconds Impala took? 1.28 seconds. Let's see whether we can run the same query or not there, but I doubt on this alias accessing sometimes. Some places. Yeah, it is accepting. So if you observe the time difference here and there, so that itself justifies why Impala is so popular in real time. It's submitting the MapReduce job. You are waiting for it like anything. Just on 12,000 records.
12,870. So Shiva, Neetu here.
Yes, Neetu.
This customer table is right now copied into RAM.
Right now copied into RAM? Is that your question?
Yes. For running the
not the entire file, entire table at a time. So just one block at a one block will be copied. Block by block will be copied into RAM and read by Impala daemons.
And it also get deleted after processing.
RAM, anything that you get copied into RAM, once the process is completed, that gets flushed from the RAM. That's the default behavior with RAMs.
Okay.
And once after the application is completed. So here, you're still waiting for its results to come up. Just on the same machine I'm running, of course, this is not a so hi-fi computer or server. High-end configuration, so but both are running on the same machine. It's running two MapReduce jobs, one after the other. The first one is completed, and the second one is running now.
But Shiva, what happens if there are? I think so. It will take same time if there are 1 million or 1 billion records, right? Or it will take more time.
Your Impala runs always faster.
Even with more number of records.
Yeah. Okay. Even with more number of records. Only thing is, if your file size just reaches a TB, 1 terabytes or something, then if you don't have enough RAM memory available on your Impala daemons, then you will get memory limit exceeded exceptions. That is something that the infrastructure team or the higher team that should make. Yep. Because it uses RAM. So if it doesn't find it, it throws that exception. That's it. See, 182 seconds. But I mean, this is something very worse. Maybe generally this is not this much factors, it will not, but in my machine it took like 182 seconds almost, like, whereas this gave the same results. You see here, same results in tabular format and better readability. See, total, you don't even have the header here. Of course, you can enable that by setting another property, but the tabular view and also fetch rows in 1.28 seconds versus 182 seconds. This is very worse scenario. Don't compare this always like 180 times faster or something like that.
Yeah. So I have a basic question. Do you have any numbers from your practical experience? Let's say.
Yeah, that's why I always give like 40 to 50 times faster. I was giving you this number.
Sure. No. I mean, in terms of seconds, let's say you have a 100 million rows.
In terms of seconds, this is a small table or something that there you might find much difference. But let's say if you are taking a 1 GB file or typically speaking 1 million record table. So 1 million record table or let me take, there was one big table which we joined and produced almost like 1.5 billion and reaching almost like 2 terabytes of data.
Okay.
It was running almost like 3.5 hours in Indonesia.
Okay.
So that data, when we copied and when we ran it in Hive, so it took almost like 6 hours of time. Okay. And whereas we brought it down to just 40 minutes in. This was one of the challenge that we faced, whether we can meet the SLA if we migrate from Netija into Hadoop. So that was the challenge.
That's pretty good actually. Okay. Interesting. Okay, thanks. This is good.
Okay. Next. So yeah, you can play with all other commands. I don't need to spoon feed like running every command and showing you. So from here onwards, you will be able to pick up. Now I have some best practices that you guys have to follow. These are from our experience. Like, so performance tuning techniques, tips and techniques. So use always Parquet file format with Impala and with Snappy compression. Maintain the file block size as around 1 GB and always try to make the tables partitioned by an appropriate column. Okay, so don't use the plain tables because it tries to load the data into RAM and RAM is so costliest thing, right? So if you try to load the entire table, obviously you are holding off other jobs. That is one impact. And other impact is that you'll get results very late when you are scanning that entire table. So keeping the advantage of partitioning from Hive, so it's always better to create your tables partitioned by an appropriate column. Okay. And in case of joins, when you are specifying the select a dot star comma b dot star from a table a join b on a dot id equal to b dot id. If you are specifying that, always follow the order of your bigger table. The larger table should be on left side. If a join b, a should be bigger and b should be smaller. If there are only two tables. If there are multiple tables, the trade-off is like this. I mean, the trend is like the largest table should be first. And after that, you have to keep your tables from the smallest to
the incremental sizes. The thing is, keeping the first table aside, reading it, and the second from second table onwards, it tries to keep that entire table into RAM. Entire table. Okay, so this is tiny enough. This copies this tiny table into the RAM memory of each of the Impala demons. And then if this is copied, and then if this is small enough to copy, then it will copy that also. And if this is small enough to copy, even that copies that also. But if this is big or big table is not able to copy, then it reads it from disk directly, from every block by block. Okay. And if you have any idea on using the hints in Oracle or some other RDBMSs in case of joins, and this feature is available only in Impala but not in Hive, you can give a hint before the join, meaning the syntax is similar, like select a dot star comma b dot star from table bigger alias a join table smaller b on a dot id equal to b dot id. So what we can say is, we can explicitly specify if your small table is right side, and in case of this is not being being stored in RAM memory or something, you can specify this hint as broadcast. Syntax is the same. Okay, so in square braces, if you specify broadcast, this table will get broadcasted into the RAM memory of all your demons. And in case of small tables, you can give the whatever the small tables that you find in front of them, you can give the broadcast hint. This is something similar to your hints in Oracle. And so instead of, if your table size is very huge, and this is bigger table, and even this is also bigger table, you can specify shuffle. So by default, it's a shuffle only. You don't need to explicitly specify, but of course, if you want to specify, you can specify just the shuffle as a hint. And then it just loads the block by block into demons, and that gets shuffled. The blocks get shuffled across all the demons. Whereas if your table size is small enough, you can specify the broadcast as hint. And this broadcast or specifying these hints is available only in Impala. Okay. And from our best practices, try to avoid joins as much as, but use the inner classes, okay? Inner or nested for strict.
Shiva, the in is usually pretty small, right?
What is it?
The in statement in Oracle and these databases is very slow.
Yeah.
Here in Impala, this is the trend that we follow. Like your in statements, inner queries run faster than your nested queries run faster than your join statement.
Okay.
And same as in Hive, we have seen like analyze table, compute column stats there, right? Here, so submit compute stats on your tables before running your queries, so that all your count related queries run faster. And this is something enabling short circuit reads cluster level. This is something in hands of your administrators.
as a developer, you won't be able to do it. This is a recommendation for your administrator. And while declaring your table definitions, try to avoid the correct data types instead of declaring some doubles also as a strings and then trying to apply some arithmetic operations and it gets through some null pointer exceptions or type conversion exceptions. Okay, so instead of messing up those things, try to give the appropriate data types at the time of table definition itself. These are some tips and tricks for the developers. Except this one point, all others holds good for you. Okay. And almost all your string functions, concat, concat, trim, split, substring, and your map functions, any typical SQL functions. So almost, I can't say 100%. I cannot say 100% because 100% is not supported. But most of those functions are supported. Okay.
Siva.
Yes, Anand.
So would you take some case study? Would you have some case study for Impala since it's a critical tool?
Case study?
Yeah, if we take like, you know, sample end to end.
End to end, this may not be the right time to give end to end. Let me complete HBase and scoop OSI also. Then I will give end to end. That makes more sense.
And is there a GUI for Impala?
I'm going to show you the GUIs for all these things. Pig, Hive, Impala, all at a time using the Hue.
Oh, so you also have a for those also? Okay.
Yeah, got it. Those also we have. I'm going to show everything at once. Okay.
No problem.
So till then, just practice, keep practicing in the shell itself. And I recommend developers to use shells only. Don't get trapped by your GUIs. You lost all your skills, command skills. And GUIs have sometimes the limitations also. Not every command that you can run from your shell can be run that easily from a GUI. I don't use at all. I don't like at all that GUI. So I will explain why also when I take that session. Okay. So at least are you good with this? At least you got some confidence that you can run in this. So the basic Impala assignment is that create tables and load data, run queries, and access the same tables in Hive and gather the performance metrics and just list down what all the differences between your Hive and Impala.
Ishu, are you going to cover the complex data types not supported in Impala?
All are not supported.
Oh, no, it's not even supported, is it? Okay, good. Thanks.
All are not supported.
Yeah, got it.
I listed them, right? Yeah, unions, map structs, even arrays.
Thanks, I missed that. Promise you I was not sleeping that time. I just missed it.
Okay. And bucketing is also not supported.
Got it. Sorry.
Yeah, no problem. So, yeah, then let's connect tomorrow at the same time with HBase.
Thanks, boss.
Questions in chat box.
is bucketing is really used in real time? For your answer, Satish, keeping the global one copy of the data instead of maintaining redundancy, we don't recommend bucketing being used in real time in Cloudera clusters. Hortonworks, they might use it. They can use it. Thing is, with bucketing, you will get some extra 5% or 2% performance improvement. Okay? Having Impala, why do we need Hive? Any use case? Yes. Simple use case is, good question, Akhila. I thought someone will ask me this question. Same numbers, if you remember the numbers that I gave. So 1.5 billion records. So 2 terabytes of data. It was running in 3.5 hours in NetEase. And it's taking 6 hours of time in Hive. But initially, it was not at all running in Impala. Not at all running in Impala. Getting memory limit exceeded exceptions in Impala. Thing is, it was trying to load all this 1.2 terabytes of information all at a time into the RAM memories of all your 20 node cluster. And my entire 20 node cluster capacity itself is 2 terabytes RAM. And out of that, only 1 TB is allocated to Impala. And 1 TB allocated for your yarn. So my Impala can never get 2 TB. Memory limit exceeded. So forget about performance improvement. First of all, you should get the results. Okay? So finally, of course, in our real time, we did lots of optimizations, creation of temporary results first by taking some, we partitioned them by some other categories that was retail domain. Let's not worry into that. So what we had to do is we had to rephrase those queries and send the results, some results, and not loading that entire data into once at a time into RAM memory. We achieved that. But the gist here, the conclusion here is that if your file sizes are too big, meaning in terms of TBs, then your Impala needs lots and lots of RAM memory. If that much RAM memory is not there, you can't even run your query at all. Of course, you will get your response after some time in Hive, but you will not at all get response in Impala. Okay, so okay. It's good for batch processing where you don't bother about, see, if you are running a weekly report, you are running on Sunday night, midnight, mm-hmm. and you need to provide that report to your clients every Tuesday. Do you mind eating up all your resources from Impala? Because if you run that big batch, big report in Impala, you will impact all other end users, eating up all your RAM memory and not leaving space for others. Correct? So that time you are not worried about the performance. You need a report. That's it. You can go with Hive and run that in Hive. Run it as a Hive script. Mm-hmm. And where, okay. if you have just a 1 million record table, not billions, 1 million record table, and you want to view a query, the end user is waiting, your customer is waiting, and you want to show those results in a UI, in a user interface screen, you can't make your customer to sit for 2-3 minutes, just seeing one record. As soon as he enters his customer ID, you should be able to show, instantly get that record back and show that to the customer. This is the status of your profile.
Okay, in real time, in ideal case, what will be the size like when we want to use in
Palo? It all depends on the your enterprise capacity and the cluster capacity and your business requirements.
Okay.
But to answer more specific to your question, maybe if you take like a million record table or 1 GB or up to, if your table sizes are 10 GB or so,
okay,
and 10 GB or so, it's good to run the queries on your Impala shell and throw those scripts results to end user. If it reaches beyond 100 GB, maybe even up to 100 GB, and if you need the results to be faster, of course you can use, because Impala
depending upon the cluster size, right?
Yeah, it depends on the cluster size. If your cluster size, if your cluster is having 2 terabytes of RAM, so to have 2 terabytes of RAM, how many machines you need? Minimum. Keeping a 256 GB RAM for one node, you need at least 8 data nodes, right? So if you have 2 TB, entire 2 TB will not allocate it for Impala, right? So you will at least allocate 1.2 minimum, a bit more for Yarn, and 800 GB for Impala. So the same way, if you take 20 nodes, so it will become almost like 4.5 TB or something. And out of which 2 TB can be allocated to Impala and 2.5 TB to Yarn. And inside that 2 TB, you should not consider that you are the only guy that will be using. Okay, so there are many things, because that are now decided by your infrastructure teams. And typically, so not more than 10 GB or maximum 50 GB or 100 GB tables.
Okay, for the mostly like this, we can go like for the daily reports and all, we can go with Impala, and for the
weekly reports and monthly reports, you can go for Hive, because they can wait.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have tight SLAs.
Yeah, true. Thank you, Shiva. Good use case.
So from Ramesh, I have a question. Man, you are getting always Spark exceptions in Hive session. I have a question on querying Hive table through SQL Spark while loading Spark context. It's saying fail to get the database default, returning no such object exception. Yes, even we were getting that warning message. That's not a hard stop. You'll still be able to you create a SQL context.sql. Inside that show tables, you will be able to. I have shown you that also. That's just a warning message. As long as you kept your hivesite.xml file into Spark conf folders, Ramesh.
Okay.
Yeah, did you copy that hivesite.xml file into Spark conf?
Yeah, I have done that. I didn't execute the show table command. Instead,
you will get it.
Okay.
You'll definitely get it.
Okay, let me try that. Sure.
Okay, so that's just a warning message. Even we used to get that in my machine. Okay. I showed you that once. Maybe.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, sure. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Otherwise, we'll start with a fresh, very different topic. And most of you guys may not be able to digest it. I mean, you may not accept that fact, the HBase architecture. It seems something like weird for you tomorrow.
Shiva, for next week, then do we want to decide upon date? Today?
Next week, mostly we won't have Monday class as you requested, because it's a long weekend, meaning your Sunday night there won't be any class. And do you mind having class on your Monday night, my Tuesday morning, or you want us to skip that also?
That'll be nice if we can skip those 2 days.
2 days?
And
people will ask for Ramjan. The Wednesday is Indian holiday.
Oh, Wednesday is Indian holiday?
Yeah, Ramjan. Then it might go that the entire week, just one class left in that week. So how many of you need a break on Ramjan?
Yeah, I don't need Monday off. Monday I'm okay.
Yeah, I'm not talking about whether you go to Masjid or something. Since it's a holiday, people plan outing something like that, right? So
yeah, got it. Yeah.
So I also don't.
Okay, but how many of you need a break on your Monday night as well? Meaning Tuesday morning IST.
I don't need.
This is Monday. Next. Even I don't need.
Okay. Yeah, Anand, if it is just you, I would recommend to view the video.
Yeah. So Monday, I'll catch.
We'll skip it. On Sunday night, okay, on your Sunday night, but Monday night, try to catch up.
Yeah, Monday night, I'll catch the recording, no problem.
Okay, so then we'll have our next class tomorrow, after that, we'll have our next class on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Three classes.
Perfect.
Okay?
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you all.
Yeah.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everybody. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you, Shiva.
Yeah. Thanks.